I ended the last video segment a little bit early, so just a couple more slides to cover from the first section, and then we'll go on to the second section really in earnest. So one thing to think about here is that because we have what we call exponential growth, where something grows, and then if it grows again, it grows on the growth, and so on and so forth. We have kind of a snowball effect, and this is what happens with compound interest or population growth or something like that. So here, the way to think about things is the amount of time it takes something to double depends on the rate of growth. And in particular, if you kind of go through the math on this and do logarithms and so on and so forth, if something is growing at r% per year, say 5% per year, then we can find out the time it takes to double as 70 divided by r, or 70 divided by 5, for instance. So if something is growing at 5% per year, the doubling time is 70 divided by 5, or 14 years. So if you had your money was growing in the bank at 5% per year, and you left it there for 28 years, it would double, then double again, because you'd have two 14-year periods, so it would actually quadruple. So, questions here for you guys. If the U.S. economy is growing at 2% per year, how many years does it take for output to double in the U.S.? And if the Chinese economy is growing at 7% per year, how long does it take output to double in China? And then building on that, well, right now, U.S. income per head is about $50,000. Chinese income per head is about $10,000. So, if there's 35 years, what will U.S. income have grown to after 35 years if it's growing at 2% per year? And what will Chinese income have grown to if it's growing at 7% per year for 35 years? And you can kind of think in terms of like, well, how many doubling times does the U.S. get in over 35 years, and how many doublings does China get in over 35 years? And again, just to see the eventual impact of these small differences in growth rates, sort of, these are periods where these sort of periods in the late 1800s or beginning of 1900s, most countries here have had some degree of industrial revolution already. And so most of them, or at least about half of them, have income per head that's about over $1,000. And the UK was the richest country in the world at that time. And notice, you know, the UK then was substantially richer than the US. So the US was maybe about 80% as rich as the UK, if you look at this 3,700 relative to 4,500. But the U.S. grew 0.3% faster per year over the next 100 years or so, and just 0.3% faster, 1.83 instead of 1.53, pretty much reversed the relative standing of the two countries. So again, just a fairly small difference in growth rates, that 0.3%, makes a really huge difference in the eventual outcome. The other sort of story to look at here would be to compare, say, Argentina, which was actually a pretty wealthy country back in 1900 by the standards of the day. It has managed to grow at 1.88%, but Japan, which was significantly less wealthy than Argentina, by growing not even 0.5% faster over the intervening 100 years or so, managed to totally overtake Argentina. So that Japan is now, relatively speaking, you know, at the pretty top of the heap economically worldwide. Maybe, you know, somewhat lower than the U.S., but you know, after that, pretty well compared to, say, Germany or Canada or the UK. Whereas Argentina, with this relatively, you know, still pretty decent growth rate, has really fallen behind here. Okay, so what is it all about? What does GDP growth ultimately come down to? Well, the first answer is it comes down to productivity. And what do we mean by productivity? When we talk about productivity, we're talking about the amount of output you can get per unit of input. And almost always, we're was talking in particular about labor productivity. And labor productivity, ideally, we would like to measure labor productivity per hour. How much output do workers in a country manufacture per hour or produce per hour in goods and services? Oftentimes, it's hard to get the hourly data, so we come down to just per worker. And the reason why this is important is that fundamentally, what a country can produce determines what it can consume. Either it can consume it directly, or it can produce stuff and then trade it with other people for the things that they have. So higher productivity is going to go ahead and lead to higher income per person. Fundamentally, again, remember that in macroeconomics, output is the same as income, which is the same as spending. So then that begs the question of, well, why is, are there big differences internationally in labor productivity? And there are three big ways in which we would notice that things are different in different countries. One is that in some countries, workers have a lot of equipment to work with and high quality equipment to work with. And pretty obviously, someone who has a bulldozer is going to get a lot more timber harvesting done than someone who just has a chainsaw, and that person is going to get a lot more timber harvesting done than someone who just has one of those two-person big saw blades that they had back in the pioneer days, and that's going to be a lot more productive than someone who just has a simple steel axe. God forbid you have just a stone axe or something. So obviously, when workers have more physical capital, that makes them more productive. At the same time, workers can have human capital. We talk about people having the tools or skills to succeed, and they're being equipped with school tools and skills through their education. So pretty obviously, we think that some types of training and education can go ahead and increase someone's productivity. And it may be even that without a certain level of human capital, it's not possible to use some types of physical capital. You know, we're not going to be able to pull someone out of the fields in a rice paddy and have them operate a bulldozer right away. They're going to need some training on that. Then last here, there are differences in natural resources, what we might call natural capital. And this is sometimes called land, but I would prefer to use the phrase natural resources or natural capital because it's everything out there. It includes water resources, air resources, and so on and so forth, things that are above the land and below the land, and so on and so forth. And, you know, in different countries, people have different levels of these different goods. Often, people look around the world and they think, well, natural resources are really what explains it. And I think I would disagree with that. If you look at a country like Switzerland or Japan, what you're going to see, or most of Western Europe for that matter, is that we have a bunch of countries there that really don't have that much in the way of natural resources. You know, if we were to look at Taiwan or Singapore or something like that, which are all relatively rich places, South Korea, relatively rich place, we would see that in terms of natural resources, they don't really have very much. And if we were to look at places like Russia or Brazil or many parts of Africa, then we would see that, yeah, there are a lot of natural resources there, but without the investments in human and physical capital to make workers more productive, those high levels of natural resources essentially don't get used very well, or they only produce, you know, just a little bit of wealth in the mining or resource extracting industry. So without these broad-based investments in physical and human capital, to equip workers and make them more productive, you're not going to get a high overall level of productivity and income in a country. So I think natural resources are vastly overstated as a source of wealth. The other thing economists think about is, well, it's not just how much physical and human capital you have and how much you have in terms of natural resources. It's also how you know how to make those things work together to become productive. So economists call technology this idea of how do we combine the factors of production to make them work as well as we can. So a distinction you might think about here is a machine itself, economists wouldn't call that technology, and economists would call that physical capital. Technology is the idea of how to build a machine. And What we think about here is that technology is essentially the first creation of knowledge, but it's not necessarily, say, for instance, the same thing as developing a skill. So, for instance, a recipe itself, how to combine eggs and so on and so forth to make a cake, that is sort of pure knowledge. How to actually successfully whisk an egg and separate an egg yolk from an egg white and mix the ingredients and put them in the pan and grease the pan properly, that's more of a skill. And notice we could sort of photocopy the recipe endlessly or put it on the internet and distribute that kind of information for free. Skill of how to do a particular thing, on the other hand, often involves some investment in human capital through practice and training and so on and so forth. That distinction does get a little bit murky, but the key question, I think, is does this kind of knowledge require people to invest in building skills so that every time a worker acquires the skill, there is this necessary investment, then it's more like human capital, or is it more sort of pure knowledge, just the idea itself, in which case we're more likely to call it technology? A couple of review questions here, and then we'll go on to our next section.